thank you for coming. I want to thank first Reverend Ann and the faith community for their warm hospitality in this beautiful church. I know that you are here working on many different issues of peace and justice. I want to thank Ann, each of you, for all of your good work in the struggle. What I've come to see as I look at why we're here, it's all about solidarity. It took me a long time, I must say, on my journey through life to learn what that word really meant, solidarity. Way back in the early 1970s, when I was ordained a Catholic priest, I was assigned to Marino's mission work in Bolivia. And this became my home for the next 5 years. And it was here where the poor really became my teachers. I'm wondering if I should use this.
Yes.
Because I've got a few more talks coming up, and my voice is not that good. Is this all right, or? It's a little better. Thanks. Bolivia, at this time, was living under a brutal dictatorship, General Hugo Banzer, who came into power through a violent coup. And it saddened me to see my country in Bolivia when I arrived, supporting this dictatorship and the men with the guns who ran the country. Banzer, General Banzer, was one of the many that we supported in that region. Next door was Chile, General Augusto Pinochet, and thugs throughout Latin, Central America in that region. It was in Bolivia that I was introduced to a new theology that I found so exciting. It's a theology that's rooted in the struggle of the poor. It comes from them. This theology gives hope to the poor. It empowers them. It encourages them to break their silence about their struggle in life. The majority of the people in Bolivia and throughout that region, as throughout the developing world, struggling for survival in these shacks without running water, not having enough food for the table, and seeing their children simply die before their time. This theology gives hope to the poor. First of all, it teaches them that a loving creator, a loving God, gave them life, gave us life. And each of our, in our countries, there's enough resources for all to live comfortably. Where there's no one that should be going to bed hungry or struggling for survival. This was not, as they say, God's intention. This theology presents a new model of church, one that gave me so much hope. Certainly not the model of church that I came from and growing up in the Catholic tradition in the U.S. It's a model of church that's very circular, getting away from that top-down model, where all are called to the table as equals, where no one at that table can claim ownership of the church, the faith community, where no one at that table can say they are superior to another. At this table, there is no one that's inferior. All are there with equal worth and dignity. And it was in my experience living in this slum on the outskirts of La Paz, Bolivia, that I was reintroduced not only to the struggle of the poor and their theology, but this all-important word, solidaridad, solidarity. Is this creeping down on me here?
Very slow.
I think it's okay. Warn me if it goes out. But really, that all-important word, solidarity, which for them, as they taught me, meant to accompany, to walk with, to be at one with, to see the struggles of others as your struggle. Solidarity. And I must say, that was really what people there did, the poor and the oppressed. They walked in solidarity with each other. They struggled for justice, worked so hard for peace. But when you have a small group who would have the power, the wealth in their hands, the poor who speak about land reform, who make up the majority of the country, who call for a living wage, who speak out and cry out for justice and peace, they really threaten their power and wealth. And often their response is very harsh, very swift, very severe. It frightened me to see to what extent people will go to protect their power when it's threatened. They will kill. They will imprison so many. They will torture. All in the name of power and wealth. But any movement that's rooted in justice simply cannot be stopped. It's unstoppable, as we've learned from so many social justice movements. Abolition of slavery, the women's suffrage movement, civil rights movement. And now this movement in the Catholic Church of women's ordination. These movements are unstoppable. There are many who will try to stop them. Their power is threatened. And they can cause a lot of suffering and put many obstacles in the way. But they cannot stop a movement that's rooted in justice. And this movement in Bolivia was all about justice. Many killed, many imprisoned, many arrested. It was in my fifth year I was among the many arrested for trying to take that word solidarity seriously. And I had to leave the country. It was a very difficult time, a lonely time. I tried to go back. It was the night of visa, persona non grata. My attention turned to El Salvador. It was right after Bishop Oscar Romero was assassinated, killed in this little church for his defense of the poor. It was in El Salvador where four churchwomen from the U.S. went to work with Bishop Romero at his invitation. And just months after he was assassinated, they were raped and killed by the Salvadoran military. Two of the women were good friends of the Marino Sisters community. The other two women from the Ursuline community in Cleveland, Ohio. When this happened to the four churchwomen, many of us went there trying to ask a basic question, how could this happen? The death of the four women brought so many of us to El Salvador. And once again, we found our country, the United States, giving guns and training to those doing the killing. It was all being carried out in our name and with our tax money. Many of us came back from El Salvador. We could not keep quiet because of what we saw and heard, and wanting to be in solidarity with the struggle there. We spoke out And when 500 Salvadoran soldiers came to Fort Benning, Georgia to start their training in combat at the height of the Civil War, a small group of us went there and said, not in our name. We protested. They sent us to prison for a year and a half. And what we learned was very important, that they could send us to prison, but we couldn't be silenced. So many of the great peacemakers taught us that. Gandhi, Cesar Chavez, Nelson Mandela, Dr. King, Rosa Parks, and the list goes on and on. Dorothy Day. The truth cannot be silenced. When we got out of prison, thousands were trying to stop the military aid. We couldn't do it. Our voices weren't strong enough. And they went after the Jesuits, these six Jesuits who ran their university in San Salvador. The military into their campus after midnight, November the 16th, 1989. And dragged these six Jesuits out of their rooms along with their co-worker, young mother, Elba, and her teenage daughter, Selena. And this became my home for the next 5 years. And it was here where the poor really became my teachers. I'm wondering if I should use this.
Yes.
A few more. It's been a long time, I must say, on my journey through life to learn what that word really meant, solidarity. Way back in the early 1970s, when I was ordained a Catholic priest, I was assigned to Marino's mission work in Bolivia. I want to thank Anne, each of you, for, you know, all of your good work in the struggle. What I've come to see as I look at why we're here, it's all about solidarity. It took me, talks coming up in my voice is not that good. Is this all right or? It's a little better. Thanks. Bolivia at this time was living under a brutal dictatorship, General Hugo Banzer, who came into power through a violent coup. Thank you for coming. I want to thank first Reverend Ann and the faith community for their warm hospitality in this beautiful church. I know that you are here working on many different issues of peace and justice.